If then, amidst the decays of health, we have learned to feel his value more as the physician of souls, if amidst the loss of property, the worth of his unsearchable riches has been more correctly estimated, if at the grave of earthly friends we have been drawn closer to him, the friend of sinners, if amidst the gloom and desolation of earthly scenes the glory of the cross has shone forth with a new and surpassing luster, if amidst privations and losses, otherwise trying and distressing, we are brought to adopt the language of the apostle, I have all things and abound, all things are mine, for I am Christ's. In this case, also, the affliction has answered its end, for that trial cannot have been in vain, which has revealed to us the glory of the Savior, and made us more Christ-like, both in our sentiments, feelings, and life. Clear views of the importance of gospel truths, and a richer unction from them resting upon the heart, acquired by sorrow, are a convincing proof of benefit from God's chastening hand. Seventhly, less dread of future trials, and a stronger trust in God for support under them, is another evidence of sanctified trial. There is about most of us, until it is removed by God's grace, a timidity, dread, and desponding feeling about afflictions, which make us afraid to encounter them. We turn away from them with dismay, as if there were no power which could support us under them, no wisdom to guide us through them, and no grace to comfort us in the midst of them. The very shadow of an approaching affliction makes our coward hearts to tremble, and causes us to cry out in unbelief, How can I endure it? We thus dishonor God by our guilty fears, and show a weakness of faith exceedingly dishonorable to us. To be cured of this weakness by affliction, and to rise out of it strong in faith and firm in trust, to feel our fears subsiding and our confidence in God established, to see new chastisements preparing for us to be endured as soon as the present ones have ceased, to behold storm clouds returning after the rain and gathering to beat upon us, when those which have lately spent their fury upon us retire, and yet to be able to say, I will trust and not be afraid, for with the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength, and he will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon him, because he trusts in him, is a genuine mark of improvement by afflictive dispensations. God's design in chastening us is to bring us to confide in him. He demands our trust and is honored by it. And it is really no small part of our sanctification. And he that goes forward from one cross to another, strengthened by the past to meet with greater courage the future, who can trust himself with all he has with greater calmness to the disposal of God, with less apprehension for the result, has not been visited in vain by the afflictive hand of God. Eighthly, a more entire consecration of the soul to God's service in general, and to some special service in particular, is also a proof of sanctified affliction. How delightful a spectacle is it to God, to angels, and to men, to see a Christian rising from the bed of his own sickness, or returning from the grave of a near relative, while his eyes are yet moistened with tears, and the heart soft with sorrow, yielding up himself afresh to the claims, the service, and the glory of God, and instead of being paralyzed with grief, or taken up with enjoyment, setting himself apart by a new dedication to God. How beautiful is the language of the psalmist in the review of his deliverance! I love the Lord, because he has heard my appeal for mercy, because he has turned his ear toward me. I will call out to him as long as I live. The ropes of death were wrapped around me, and the horrors of the grave overcame me. I encountered trouble and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is compassionate. The Lord guards the simple. I was helpless, and he saved me. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. For you, Lord, rescued me from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I believed, even when I said, I am severely afflicted. How can I repay the Lord for all the good he has done for me? I will take the cup of salvation and worship the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Lord, I am indeed your servant. I am your servant. You have loosened my bonds. I will offer you a sacrifice of thanksgiving and will worship the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the very presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house. Hallelujah. This is the language of sanctified affliction. Then, when the Christian is seen giving himself afresh to the service of God, in a more devoted attendance upon all the means of grace, private, domestic, and public, when his liberality is more diffusive and his zeal more ardent, when he seems concerned, inventive, and laborious to show his gratitude and love by new acts of devotedness, and former measures of service will not content him, it is a convincing evidence that he has derived benefit from tribulation. Ninthly, increased sympathy for others in their affliction is a proof that our own affliction has done us good. In some cases, sorrow has hardened the heart and made men selfish. It has drawn off all their attention from others and concentrated it on themselves. This is a dark sign. Nothing can be a stronger proof that trials have done us harm instead of good than when they have blunted our susceptibilities, hardened our hearts, and put all our tears in reserve for ourselves. Nor, on the contrary, can there be a more convincing evidence that they have benefited us than that there is an increase of sympathy and a greater readiness to weep with those who weep. It is a delightful exhibition of a mind softened and sanctified by affliction to see a person, on recovering from it, still holding in remembrance the wormwood and the gall, and instead of giving himself to selfish enjoyment, rather going forth with quickened sensibilities to support and comfort the distressed. Such are the proofs, evidences, and results of sanctified affliction. May they be found in you, my dear friends, and in your pastor. Trials abound in this world. It is a valley of tears. Happy will it be for us if we shall emerge from it at length into that blessed region where God shall wipe away all tears from every eye. I reckon, said the blessed Paul, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. We know that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. With such internal consolations as the gospel affords, and with such a peace as passes understanding, what external tribulations may we not endure, and endure not only with patience, but with joyfulness? It is beautifully said by Leighton, all outward distress to a mind, thus at peace, is but as the rattling hail upon the tiles to him who sits within the house at a sumptuous feast. Do not dread affliction, or at least dread far more being left to grow worldly and sinful for lack of affliction, or being allowed to endure the pain of affliction without reaping the benefit of it. The losses, the pains, the disappointments of the present state, if blessed for our spiritual good, will all fit us for the state where there shall be no more sorrow nor crying. The drops of sanctified grief are the seeds of immortal joy. There will soon be a last tear, but never a last joy. Fix your heart upon holiness as the preparative for heaven, and be little concerned at what expense of present ease and possessions it be obtained, so long as holiness is obtained. The first look at Jesus as he is, and the first moment spent in heaven, will make ample amends for the longest and the saddest life on earth. Abound in hope, a lively hope, of that inheritance which is incorruptible and undefiled and unfading, reserved in heaven for you. Be much in prayer for the presence and help of the Spirit of God as a comforter. Without his aid, the least trial will distress you, and with it, the greatest cannot crush you. God is able to support and comfort, as well as save to the uttermost. And none of us can tell what, in either case, the uttermost of God can do.